Welcome to this Airman audio production of Pilot's Handbook of Aeronautical Knowledge, FAA H8083-25B, written by the Federal Aviation Administration, expertly adapted for audio by Airman Audio, and narrated by Douglas Martin. Chapter 1. Introduction to Flying. The Pilot's Handbook of Aeronautical Knowledge provides basic knowledge for the student pilot learning to fly, as well as pilots seeking advanced pilot certification. For detailed information on a variety of specialized flight topics, refer to specific Federal Aviation Administration, FAA, handbooks, and advisory circulars, ACs. This chapter offers a brief history of flight, introduces the history and role of the FAA in civil aviation, FAA regulations and standards, government references and publications, eligibility for pilot certificates, available routes to flight instruction, the role of the Certificated Flight Instructor, CFI, and Designated Pilot Examiner, DPE, in flight training, practical test standards, PTS, and new industry-developed Airman Certification Standards, ACS, framework that will eventually replace the PTS. History of flight. From prehistoric times, humans have watched the flight of birds and longed to imitate them, but lacked the power to do so. Logic dictated that if the small muscles of birds can lift them into the air and sustain them, then the larger muscles of humans should be able to duplicate the feat. No one knew about the intricate mesh of muscles, sinew, heart, breathing system, and devices, not unlike wing flaps, variable camber, and spoilers of the modern airplane that enabled a bird to fly. Still, thousands of years and countless lives were lost in attempts to fly like birds. The identity of the first birdmen, who fitted themselves with wings and leapt off of cliffs in an effort to fly, are lost in time. But each failure gave those who wished to fly questions that needed to be answered. Where had the wing flappers gone wrong? Philosophers, scientists, and inventors offered solutions, but no one could add wings to the human body and soar like a bird. During the 1500s, Leonardo da Vinci filled pages of his notebooks with sketches of proposed flying machines. But most of his ideas were flawed because he clung to the idea of bird-like wings. By 1655, mathematician, physicist, and inventor Robert Hooke concluded that the human body does not possess the strength to power artificial wings. He believed human flight would require some form of artificial propulsion. The quest for human flight led some practitioners in another direction. In 1783, the first manned hot air balloon, crafted by Joseph and Etienne Montgolfier, flew for 23 minutes. 10 days later, Professor Jacques Charles flew the first gas balloon. A madness for balloon flight captivated the public's imagination, and for a time, flying enthusiasts turned their expertise to the promise of lighter-than-air flight. But for all its majesty in the air, the balloon was little more than a billowing heap of cloth capable of no more than a one-way, downwind journey. Balloons solved the problem of lift, but that was only one of the problems of human flight. The ability to control speed and direction eluded balloonists. The solution to that problem lay in a child's toy, familiar to the East for 2,000 years, but not introduced to the West until the 13th century, the kite. The kites used by the Chinese for aerial observation, to test winds for sailing, as a signaling device, and as a toy, held many of the answers to lifting a heavier-than-air device into the air. One of the men who believed the study of kites unlocked the secrets of winged flight was Sir George Cayley. Born in England 10 years before the Montgolfier balloon flight, Cayley spent his 84 years seeking to develop a heavier-than-air vehicle supported by kite-shaped wings. The father of aerial navigation, Cayley discovered the basic principles on which the modern science of aeronautics is founded, built what is recognized as the first successful flying model, and tested the first full-size man-carrying airplane. For the half century after Cayley's death, countless scientists, flying enthusiasts, and inventors worked toward building a powered flying machine. Men such as William Samuel Henson, who designed a huge monoplane that was propelled by a steam engine housed inside the fuselage, and Otto Lilienthal, who proved human flight in aircraft heavier than air was practical, worked toward the dream of powered flight, a dream turned into reality by Wilbur and Orville Wright at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina, on December 17, 1903. The bicycle-building Wright brothers of Dayton, Ohio, had experimented for 4 years with kites, their own homemade wind tunnel, and different engines to power their biplane. One of their great achievements in flight was proving the value of the scientific rather than a build-it-and-see approach. Their biplane, the Flyer, combined inspired design and engineering with superior craftsmanship. By the afternoon of December 17th, the Wright brothers had flown a total of 98 seconds on four flights. The age of flight had arrived. History of the Federal Aviation Administration, FAA. During the early years of manned flight, aviation was a free-for-all because no government body was in place to establish policies or regulate and enforce safety standards. Individuals were free to conduct flights and operate aircraft with no government oversight. Most of the early flights were conducted for sport. Aviation was expensive and became the playground of the wealthy. Since these early airplanes were small, many people doubted their commercial value. One group of individuals believed otherwise, and they became the genesis for modern airline travel. P.E. Fansler, a Florida businessman living in St. Petersburg, approached Tom Benoit of the Benoit Aircraft Company in St. Louis, Missouri, about starting a flight route from St. Petersburg across the waterway to Tampa. Benoit suggested using his Safety First airboat, and the two men signed an agreement for what would become the first scheduled airline in the United States. The first aircraft was delivered to St. Petersburg and made the first test flight on December 31, 1913. A public auction decided who would win the honor of becoming the first paying airline customer. The former mayor of St. Petersburg, A.C. File, made the winning bid of $400, which secured his place in history as the first paying airline passenger. On January 1, 1914, the first scheduled airline flight was conducted. The flight length was 21 miles and lasted 23 minutes due to a headwind. The return trip took 20 minutes. The line, which was subsidized by Florida businessmen, continued for 4 months and offered regular passage for $5 per person or per 100 pounds of cargo. Shortly after the opening of the line, Benoit added a new airboat that afforded more protection from spray during takeoff and landing. The routes were also extended to Manatee, Bradenton, and Sarasota, giving further credence to the idea of a profitable commercial airline. The St. Petersburg-Tampa airboat line continued throughout the winter months, with flights finally being suspended when the winter tourist industry began to dry up. The airline operated for only 4 months, but 1,205 passengers were carried without injury. This experiment proved commercial passenger airline travel was viable. The advent of World War I offered the airplane a chance to demonstrate its varied capabilities. It began the war as a reconnaissance platform, but by 1918, airplanes were being mass-produced to serve as fighters, bombers, trainers, as well as reconnaissance platforms. Aviation advocates continued to look for ways to use airplanes. Airmail service was a popular idea, but the war prevented the Postal Service from having access to airplanes. The War Department and Postal Service reached an agreement in 1918. The Army would use the mail service to train its pilots in flying cross-country. The first airmail flight was conducted on May 15, 1918, between New York and Washington, D.C. The flight was not considered spectacular. The pilot became lost and landed at the wrong airfield. In August of 1918, the United States Postal Service took control of the airmail routes and brought the existing Army airmail pilots and their planes into the program as postal employees. Transcontinental Airmail Route. Airmail routes continued to expand until the Transcontinental Mail Route was inaugurated. This route spanned from San Francisco to New York for a total distance of 2,612 miles, with 13 intermediate stops along the way. On May 20, 1926, Congress passed the Air Commerce Act, which served as the cornerstone for aviation within the United States. This legislation was supported by leaders in the aviation industry who felt that the airplane could not reach its full potential without assistance from the federal government in improving safety. The Air Commerce Act charged the Secretary of Commerce with fostering air commerce, issuing and enforcing air traffic rules, licensing pilots, certificating aircraft, establishing airways, and operating and maintaining aids to air navigation. The Department of Commerce created a new aeronautics branch, whose primary mission was to provide oversight for the aviation industry. In addition, the aeronautics branch took over the construction and operation of the nation's system of lighted airways. The Postal Service, as part of the Transcontinental Airmail Route System, had initiated this system. The Department of Commerce made significant advances in aviation communications, including the introduction of radio beacons as an effective means of navigation. Built at intervals of approximately 10 miles apart, the standard beacon tower was 51 feet high and was topped with a powerful rotating light. Below the rotating light, two course lights pointed forward and back along the airway. The course lights flashed a code to identify the beacon's number. The tower usually stood in the center of a concrete arrow 70 feet long. A generator shed, where required, stood at the feather end of the arrow. Federal Certification of Pilots and Mechanics. The Aeronautics branch of the Department of Commerce began pilot certification with the first license issued on April 6, 1927. The recipient was the chief of the Aeronautics branch, William P. McCracken, Jr. Orville Wright, who was no longer an active flyer, had declined the honor. McCracken's license was the first issued to a pilot by a civilian agency of the federal government. Some 3 months later, the Aeronautics branch issued the first federal aircraft mechanic license. Equally important for safety was the establishment of a system of certification for aircraft. On March 29, 1927, the Aeronautics branch issued the first airworthiness type certificate to the Buell Airster CA-3, a three-place open biplane. In 1934, to recognize the tremendous strides made in aviation and to display the enhanced status within the department, the Aeronautics branch was renamed the Bureau of Air Commerce, more accurately reflecting the status of the organization within the Department of Commerce. Within this time frame, the Bureau of Air Commerce brought together a group of airlines and encouraged them to form the first three air traffic control, ATC, facilities along the established air routes. Then, in 1936, the Bureau of Air Commerce took over the responsibilities of operating the centers and continued to advance the ATC facilities. ATC has come a long way from the early controllers using maps, chalkboards, and performing mental math calculations in order to separate aircraft along flight routes. The Civil Aeronautics Act of 1938. In 1938, the Civil Aeronautics Act transferred the civil aviation responsibilities to a newly created independent body, named the Civil Aeronautics Authority, CAA. This act empowered the CAA to regulate airfares and establish new routes for the airlines to service. President Franklin Roosevelt split the CAA into two agencies, the Civil Aeronautics Administration, CAA, and the Civil Aeronautics Board, CAB. Both agencies were still part of the Department of Commerce, but the CAB functioned independently of the Secretary of Commerce. The role of the CAA was to facilitate ATC, certification of airmen and aircraft, rule enforcement, and the development of new airways. The CAB was charged with rulemaking to enhance safety, accident investigation, and the economic regulation of the airlines. Then, in 1946, Congress gave the CAA the responsibility of administering the Federal Aid Airport Program. This program was designed to promote the establishment of civil airports throughout the country. The Federal Aviation Act of 1958. By mid-century, air traffic had increased, and jet aircraft had been introduced into the civil aviation arena. A series of mid-air collisions underlined the need for more regulation of the aviation industry. Aircraft were not only increasing in numbers, but were now streaking across the skies at much higher speeds. The Federal Aviation Act of 1958 established a new independent body that assumed the roles of the CAA and transferred the rulemaking authority of the CAB to the newly created Federal Aviation Agency, FAA. In addition, the FAA was given complete control of the common civil military system of air navigation and ATC. The man who was given the honor of being the first administrator of the FAA was former Air Force General Elwood Richard Pete Quesada. He served as the administrator from 1959 to 1961. Department of Transportation. On October 15, 1966, Congress established the Department of Transportation, DOT, which was given oversight of the transportation industry within the United States. The result was a combination of both air and surface transportation. Its mission was, and is, to serve the United States by ensuring a fast, safe, efficient, accessible, and convenient transportation system meeting vital national interests and enhancing the quality of life of the American people, then, now, and into the future. The DOT began operation on April 1, 1967. At this same time, the Federal Aviation Agency was renamed to the Federal Aviation Administration, FAA. The role of the CAB was assumed by the newly created National Transportation Safety Board, NTSB, which was charged with the investigation of all transportation accidents within the United States. As aviation continued to grow, the FAA took on additional duties and responsibilities. With the hijacking epidemic of the 1960s, the FAA was responsible for increasing the security duties of aviation both on the ground and in the air. After September 11, 2001, the duties were transferred to a newly created body called the Department of Homeland Security, DHS. With numerous aircraft flying in and out of larger cities, the FAA began to concentrate on the environmental aspect of aviation by establishing and regulating the noise standards of aircraft. Additionally, in the 1960s and 1970s, the FAA began to regulate high altitude, over 500 feet, kite and balloon flying. In 1970, more duties were assumed by the FAA in the addition of a new federal airport aid program and increased responsibility for airport safety. ATC automation. By the mid-1970s, the FAA had achieved a semi-automated ATC system based on a marriage of radar and computer technology. By automating certain routine tasks, the system allowed controllers to concentrate more efficiently on the vital task of providing aircraft separation. Data appearing directly on the controller's scopes provided the identity, altitude, and ground speed of aircraft carrying radar beacons. Despite its effectiveness, this system required enhancement to keep pace with the increased air traffic of the late 1970s. The increase was due in part to the competitive environment created by the Airline Deregulation Act of 1978. This law phased out CAB's economic regulation of the airlines, and CAB ceased to exist at the end of 1984. To meet the challenge of traffic growth, the FAA unveiled the National Airspace System, NAS, plan in January 1982. The new plan called for more advanced systems for en route and terminal ATC, modernized flight service stations, and improvements in ground-to-air surveillance and communication. The Professional Air Traffic Controllers Organization Strike. While preparing the NAS plan, the FAA faced a strike by key members of its workforce. An earlier period of discord between management and the Professional Air Traffic Controllers Organization, PATCO, culminated in a 1970 sick-out by 3,000 controllers. Although controllers subsequently gained additional wage and retirement benefits, another period of tension led to an illegal strike in August 1981. The government dismissed over 11,000 strike participants and decertified PATCO. By the spring of 1984, the FAA ended the last of the special restrictions imposed to keep the airspace system operating safely during the strike. The Airline Deregulation Act of 1978. Until 1978, the CAB regulated many areas of commercial aviation, such as fares, routes, and schedules. The Airline Deregulation Act of 1978, however, removed many of these controls, thus changing the face of civil aviation in the United States. After deregulation, unfettered free competition ushered in a new era in passenger air travel. The CAB had three main functions: to award routes to airlines, to limit the entry of air carriers into new markets, and to regulate fares for passengers. Much of the established practices of commercial passenger travel within the United States went back to the policies of Walter Folger Brown, the United States Postmaster General during the administration of President Herbert Hoover. Brown had changed the mail payment system to encourage the manufacture of passenger aircraft instead of mail-carrying aircraft. His influence was crucial in awarding contracts and helped create four major domestic airlines: United, American, Eastern, and Transcontinental and Western Air, TWA. Similarly, Brown had also helped give Pan American a monopoly on international routes. The push to deregulate, or at least to reform the existing laws governing passenger carriers, was accelerated by President Jimmy Carter, who appointed economist and former professor Alfred Kahn, a vocal supporter of deregulation, to head the CAB. A second force to deregulate emerged from abroad. In 1977, Freddie Laker, a British entrepreneur who owned Laker Airways, created the SkyTrain service, which offered extraordinarily cheap fares for transatlantic flights. Laker's offerings coincided with a boom in low-cost domestic flights, as the CAB eased some limitations on charter flights, flights offered by companies that do not actually own planes but leased them from the major airlines. The big air carriers responded by proposing their own lower fares. For example, American Airlines, the country's second largest airline, obtained CAB approval for Super Saver tickets. All of these events proved to be favorable for large-scale deregulation. In November 1977, Congress formally deregulated air cargo. In late 1978, Congress passed the Airline Deregulation Act of 1978, legislation that had been principally authored by Senators Edward Kennedy and Howard Cannon. There was stiff opposition to the bill, from the major airlines who feared free competition, from labor unions who feared non-union employees, and from safety advocates who feared that safety would be sacrificed. Public support was, however, strong enough to pass the act. The act appeased the major airlines by offering generous subsidies and pleased workers by offering high unemployment benefits if they lost their jobs as a result. The most important effect of the act, whose laws were slowly phased in, was on the passenger market. For the first time in 40 years, airlines could enter the market or, from 1981, expand their routes as they saw fit. Airlines, from 1982, also had full freedom to set their fares. In 1984, the CAB was finally abolished since its primary duty of regulating the airline industry was no longer necessary. The role of the FAA. The Code of Federal Regulations. The FAA is empowered by regulations to promote aviation safety and establish safety standards for civil aviation. The FAA achieves these objectives under the Code of Federal Regulations, CFR, which is the codification of the general and permanent rules published by the executive departments and agencies of the United States government. The regulations are divided into 50 different codes, called titles, that represent broad areas subject to federal regulation. FAA regulations are listed under Title 14, Aeronautics and Space, which encompasses all aspects of civil aviation, from how to earn a pilot's certificate to maintenance of an aircraft. Title 14 CFR Chapter 1, Federal Aviation Administration, is broken down into subchapters A through N, which cover definitions, rules, aircraft, air traffic, operations, schools, administrative regulations, and numerous other topics related to aeronautics. For the pilot, certain parts of 14 CFR are more relevant than others. During flight training, it is helpful for the pilot to become familiar with the parts and subparts that relate to flight training and pilot certification. For instance, 14 CFR Part 61 pertains to the certification of pilots, flight instructors, and ground instructors. It also defines the eligibility, aeronautical knowledge, and flight proficiency, as well as training and testing requirements for each type of pilot certificate issued. 14 CFR Part 91 provides guidance in the areas of general flight rules, visual flight rules, VFR, and instrument flight rules, IFR, while 14 CFR Part 43 covers aircraft maintenance, preventive maintenance, rebuilding, and alterations. Primary locations of the FAA. The FAA headquarters are in Washington, D.C., and there are 9 regional offices strategically located across the United States. The agency's 2 largest field facilities are the Mike Monroney Aeronautical Center, MMAC, in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, and the William J. Hughes Technical Center, WJHTC, in Atlantic City, New Jersey. Home to FAA training and logistics services, the MMAC provides a number of aviation safety-related and business support services. The WJHTC is the premier aviation research and development and test and evaluation facility in the country. The center's programs include testing and evaluation in ATC, communication, navigation, airports, aircraft safety, and security. Furthermore, the WJHTC is active in long-range development of innovative aviation systems and concepts, development of new ATC equipment and software, and modification of existing systems and procedures. Field offices. Flight Standards Service. Within the FAA, the Flight Standards Service promotes safe air transportation by setting the standards for certification and oversight of airmen, air operators, air agencies, and designees. It also promotes safety of flight of civil aircraft and air commerce by accomplishing certification, inspection, surveillance, investigation, and enforcement, setting regulations and standards, and managing the system for registration of civil aircraft and all airmen records. The focus of interaction between Flight Standards Service and the aviation community and general public is the Flight Standards District Office, FISDO. The FAA has approximately 80 FISDOs. These offices provide information and services for the aviation community. FISDO phone numbers are listed in the telephone directory under Government Offices, DOT, FAA. Another convenient method of finding a local office is to use the FISDO locator, available at www.faa.gov. In addition to accident investigation and the enforcement of aviation regulations, the FISDO is also responsible for the certification and surveillance of air carriers, air operators, flight schools, training centers, and airmen, including pilots and flight instructors. Each FISDO is staffed by aviation safety inspectors, ASIs, who play a key role in making the nation's aviation system safe. Aviation Safety Inspector. The ASIs administer and enforce safety regulations and standards for the production, operation, maintenance, and modification of aircraft used in civil aviation. They also specialize in conducting inspections of various aspects of the aviation system, such as aircraft and parts manufacturing, aircraft operation, aircraft airworthiness, and cabin safety. ASIs must complete a training program at the FAA Academy in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, which includes airman evaluation and pilot testing techniques and procedures. ASIs also receive extensive on-the-job training and recurrent training on a regular basis. The FAA has approximately 3,700 inspectors located in its FISDO offices. All questions concerning pilot certification and requests for other aviation information or services should be directed to the local FISDO. FAA Safety Team. The FAA is dedicated to improving the safety of United States civilian aviation by conveying safety principles and practices through training, outreach, and education. The FAA Safety Team, FAS Team, exemplifies this commitment. The FAS Team has replaced the Aviation Safety Program, ASP, whose education of airmen on all types of safety subjects successfully reduced accidents. Its success led to its demise because the easy-to-fix accident causes have been addressed. To take aviation safety one step further, Flight Standards Service created the FAS Team, which is devoted to reducing aircraft accidents by using a coordinated effort to focus resources on elusive accident causes. Each of the FAA's 9 regions has a regional FAS Team office dedicated to this new safety program and managed by the Regional FAS Team Manager, RFM. The FAS Team is teaming up with individuals and the aviation industry to create a unified effort against accidents and tip the safety culture in the right direction. To learn more about this effort to improve aviation safety, to take a course at their online learning center, or to join the FAS Team, visit their website at www.faasafety.gov. Obtaining assistance from the FAA. Information can be obtained from the FAA by phone, internet, email, or mail. To talk to the FAA toll-free 24 hours a day, call 1-866-TEL-FAA, 1-866-835-5322. To visit the FAA's website, go to www.faa.gov. Individuals can also email an FAA representative at a local FISDO office by accessing the staff email address available via the Contact FAA link at the bottom of the FAA homepage. Letters can be sent to the Federal Aviation Administration at this address: 800 Independence Avenue, Southwest, Washington, D.C., 20591. FAA Reference Material. The FAA provides a variety of important reference material for the student as well as the advanced civil aviation pilot. In addition to the regulations provided online by the FAA, several other publications are available to the user. Almost all reference material is available online at www.faa.gov in downloadable format. Commercial aviation publishers also provide published and online reference material to further aid the aviation pilot. Aeronautical Information Manual, AIM. The Aeronautical Information Manual, AIM, is the official guide to basic flight information and ATC procedures for the aviation community flying in the NAS of the United States. An international version containing parallel information as well as specific information on international airports is also available. The AIM also contains information of interest to pilots, such as health and medical facts, flight safety, a pilot or controller glossary of terms used in the system, and information on safety, accidents, and reporting of hazards. This manual is offered for sale on a subscription basis or is available online at www.bookstore.gpo.gov. Order forms are provided at the beginning of the manual or online and should be sent to the Superintendent of Documents, United States Government Printing Office, GPO. The AIM is complemented by other operational publications that are available via separate subscriptions or online. Handbooks. Handbooks are developed to provide specific information about a particular topic that enhances training or understanding. The FAA publishes a variety of handbooks that generally fall into 3 categories: aircraft, aviation, and examiners and inspectors. These include the Aeronautical Information Manual, the Aviation Instructor's Handbook, the Instrument Flying Handbook, the Instrument Procedures Handbook, and several aircraft flying handbooks, among others. They can be purchased from the Superintendent of Documents or downloaded at www.faa.gov/regulationspolicies. Aviation handbooks are also published by various commercial aviation companies. Aircraft flight manuals, commonly called pilot operating handbooks, POH, are documents developed by the airplane manufacturer, approved by the FAA, and are specific to a particular make and model aircraft by serial number. This subject is covered in greater detail in Chapter 8. Advisory circulars. An advisory circular, AC, is an informational document that the FAA wants to distribute to the aviation community. This can be in the form of a textbook used in a classroom or a one-page document. Some ACs are free, while others cost money. They are to be used for information only and are not regulations. The FAA website provides a database that is a searchable repository of all aviation safety ACs. All ACs, current and historical, are provided and can be viewed as a PDF copy. ACs provide a single, uniform, agency-wide system that the FAA uses to deliver advisory material to FAA customers, industry, the aviation community, and the public. An AC may be needed to provide an acceptable, clearly understood method for complying with a regulation, standardize implementation of a regulation, or harmonize implementation for the international aviation community, resolve a general misunderstanding of a regulation, respond to a request from some government entity, such as General Accounting Office, NTSB, or the Office of the Inspector General, help the industry and FAA effectively implement a regulation, explain requirements and limits of an FAA grant program, or expand on standards needed to promote aviation safety, including the safe operation of airports. There are three parts to an AC number, as in 2542C. The first part of the number identifies the subject matter area of the AC and corresponds to the appropriate 14 CFR part. For example, an AC on certification, pilots, and flight and ground instructors is numbered as AC6165E. Since ACs are numbered sequentially within each subject area, the second part of the number, in this case 65, identifies this sequence. The third part of the number is a letter assigned by the originating office and shows the revision sequence if an AC is revised. The first version of an AC does not have a revision letter. Flight publications. The FAA, in concert with other government agencies, orchestrates the publication and changes to publications that are key to safe flight, such as sectional VFR charts, IFR charts, and the chart supplement US. Pilot and aeronautical information. Notices to airmen. Notices to airmen, or NOTAMs, are time-critical aeronautical information, either temporary in nature or not sufficiently known in advance to permit publication on aeronautical charts or in other operational publications. The information receives immediate dissemination via the National Notice to Airmen system. NOTAMs contain current notices to airmen that are considered essential to the safety of flight, as well as supplemental data affecting other operational publications. There are many different reasons that NOTAMs are issued. For example, hazards, such as air shows, parachute jumps, kite flying, and rocket launches. Flights by important people, such as heads of state. Closed runways. Inoperable radio navigational aids. Military exercises with resulting airspace restrictions. Inoperable lights on tall obstructions. Temporary erection of obstacles near airfields. Passage of flocks of birds through airspace, known as a bird TAM. Notifications of runway, taxiway, or apron status with respect to snow, ice, and standing water, a snow TAM. Notifications of an operationally significant change in volcanic ash or other dust contamination, an ash TAM. Or software code risk announcements with associated patches to reduce specific vulnerabilities. NOTAM information is generally classified into four categories. NOTAM D, which are NOTAMs that receive distant dissemination. Flight Data Center, FDC NOTAMs, Pointer NOTAMs, and Military NOTAMs pertaining to military airports or nav aids that are part of the NAS. NOTAMs are available through Flight Service Station, FSS, Direct User Access Terminal Service, DUATS, private vendors, and many online websites. NOTAM D information. NOTAM D information is disseminated for all navigational facilities that are part of the NAS and all public use airports, seaplane bases, and heliports listed in the chart supplement US, formerly the Airport Facility Directory. NOTAM D information now includes such data as taxiway closures, personnel and equipment near or crossing runways, and airport lighting aids that do not affect instrument approach criteria, such as visual approach slope indicator, VASI. All D NOTAMs are required to have one of these keywords as the first part of the text: RWY for runway, TWY for taxiway, ramp, apron, AD for aerodrome, OBST for obstruction, NAV for navigation, COM for communications, SVC for service, airspace, U for unverified information, or O for other potentially beneficial information. FDC NOTAMs. FDC NOTAMs are issued by the National Flight Data Center and contain information that is regulatory in nature, pertaining to flight including, but not limited to, changes to charts, procedures, and airspace usage. FDC NOTAMs refer to information that is regulatory in nature, including interim IFR flight procedures, such as airway structure changes, instrument approach procedure changes, and general airspace changes. Temporary flight restrictions, such as disaster areas, special events generating high interest, and hijacking. Flight restrictions in the proximity of the president and other parties. 14 CFR Part 139 Certificated Airport Condition Changes. Snow conditions affecting glide slope operation. Air defense emergencies. Emergency flight rules. Substitute airway routes. Special data. U.S. government charting corrections. And laser activity. NOTAM composition. NOTAMs contain these elements ordered from left to right: an exclamation point, the identifier of the accountability location, the identifier of the affected facility or location, one of the keywords mentioned earlier, surface identification, such as the runway identification for runway-related NOTAMs or taxiway identification for taxiway-related NOTAMs, the condition being reported, and the effective time or times of the NOTAM condition. Altitude and height are in feet mean sea level, MSL, up to 17,999, and in flight levels, FL, for 18,000 and above. When MSL is not known, above ground level, AGL, will be written. When time is expressed in a NOTAM, the day begins at 0000 and ends at 2359. Times used in the NOTAM system are Universal Time Coordinated, UTC, and shall be stated in 10 digits, year, month, day, hour, and minute. NOTAM dissemination and availability. The system for disseminating aeronautical information is made up of two subsystems, the Airman's Information System, AIS, and the NOTAM system. The AIS consists of aeronautical charts depicting permanent baseline data, as well as flight information publications outlining baseline data. Aeronautical charts include IFR charts, such as en route high altitude conterminous US, en route low-altitude conterminous U.S., Alaska charts, and Pacific charts, U.S. terminal procedures, such as departure procedures, DPs, standard terminal arrivals, STARs, and standard instrument approach procedures, SIAPs, and VFR charts, such as sectional aeronautical charts, terminal area charts, TAC, and world aeronautical charts, WAC. Flight information publications include Notices to Airmen, NTAP, published every 28 days, Chart Supplement US, formerly the Airport Facility Directory, Pacific Chart Supplement, Alaska Supplement, Alaska Terminal, and the Aeronautical Information Manual, AIM. NOTAMs are available in printed form through subscription from the Superintendent of Documents, from an FSS, or online at PilotWeb, which provides access to current NOTAM information. Local airport NOTAMs can be obtained online from various websites, such as fltplan.com and aopa.org. Most sites require a free registration and acceptance of terms, but offer pilots updated NOTAMs and TFRs. Safety Program Airman Notification System. In 2004, the FAA launched the Safety Program Airman Notification System, SPANS, an online event notification system that provides timely and easy-to-assess seminar and event information notification for airmen. The SPAN system is taking the place of the current paper-based mail system. This provides better service to airmen while reducing costs for the FAA. Anyone can search the SPANS system and register for events. To learn more about SPANS, visit www.faasafety.gov/spans. Aircraft classifications and ultralight vehicles. The FAA uses various ways to classify or group machines operated or flown in the air. The most general grouping uses the term aircraft. This term is in 14 CFR 1.1 and means a device that is used or intended to be used for flight in the air. Ultralight vehicle is another general term the FAA uses. This term is defined in 14 CFR 103. As the term implies, powered ultralight vehicles must weigh less than 254 pounds empty weight, and unpowered ultralight vehicles must weigh less than 155 pounds. Rules for ultralight vehicles are significantly different from rules for aircraft. Ultralight vehicle certification, registration, and operation rules are also contained in 14 CFR 103. The FAA differentiates aircraft by their characteristics and physical properties. Key groupings defined in 14 CFR 1.1 include airplane, an engine-driven fixed-wing aircraft heavier than air that is supported in flight by the dynamic reaction of the air against its wings. Glider, a heavier-than-air aircraft that is supported in flight by the dynamic reaction of the air against its lifting surfaces and whose free flight does not depend principally on an engine. Lighter-than-air aircraft, an aircraft that can rise and remain suspended by using contained gas weighing less than the air that is displaced by the gas. Lighter-than-air aircrafts include airships, engine-driven aircrafts that can be steered, and balloons, aircrafts that are not engine-driven and that sustain flight through the use of either gas buoyancy or an airborne heater. Powered lift, a heavier-than-air aircraft capable of vertical takeoff, vertical landing, and low-speed flight that depends principally on engine-driven lift devices or engine thrust for lift during these flight regimes and on non-rotating airfoil for lift during horizontal flight. Powered parachute, a powered aircraft comprised of a flexible or semi-rigid wing connected to a fuselage so that the wing is not in position for flight until the aircraft is in motion. The fuselage of a powered parachute contains the aircraft engine, a seat for each occupant, and is attached to the aircraft's landing gear. Rocket, an aircraft propelled by ejected expanding gases generated in the engine from self-contained propellants and not dependent on the intake of outside substances. It includes any part which becomes separated during the operation. Rotorcraft, a heavier-than-air aircraft that depends principally for its support in flight on the lift generated by one or more rotors. Rotorcrafts include gyroplanes, whose rotors are not engine-driven except for initial starting, but are made to rotate by action of the air when the rotorcraft is moving, and whose means of propulsion, consisting usually of conventional propellers, is independent of the rotor system. And helicopters, a rotorcraft that, for its horizontal motion, depends principally on its engine-driven rotors. Weight shift control. A powered aircraft with a framed pivoting wing and a fuselage controllable only in pitch and roll by the pilot's ability to change the aircraft's center of gravity with respect to the wing. Flight control of the aircraft depends on the wing's ability to flexibly deform rather than the use of control surfaces. Size and weight are other methods used in 14 CFR 1.1 to group aircraft. A large aircraft is an aircraft of more than 12,500 pounds, maximum certificated takeoff weight. A small aircraft is an aircraft of 12,500 pounds or less, maximum certificated takeoff weight. And a light sport aircraft, LSA, is an aircraft other than a helicopter or powered lift that, since its original certification, has continued to meet the definition in 14 CFR 1.1. LSAs can include airplanes, airships, balloons, gliders, gyroplanes, powered parachutes, and weight shift control. We also use broad classifications of aircraft with respect to the certification of airmen or with respect to the certification of the aircraft themselves. We will discuss certification further in the next section and in Chapter 3. These definitions are included in 14 CFR 1.1. 1. Category. As used with respect to the certification, ratings, privileges, and limitations of airmen, category means a broad classification of aircraft. Examples include airplane, rotorcraft, glider, and lighter-than-air. As used with respect to the certification of aircraft, category means a grouping of aircraft based upon intended use or operating limitations. Examples include transport, normal, utility, acrobatic, limited, restricted, and provisional. 2. Class. As used with respect to the certification, ratings, privileges, and limitations of airmen, class means a classification of aircraft within a category having similar operating characteristics. Examples include single engine, multi-engine, land, water, gyroplane, helicopter, airship, and free balloon. As used with respect to the certification of aircraft, class means a broad grouping of aircraft having similar characteristics of propulsion, flight, or landing. Examples include airplane, rotorcraft, glider, balloon, land plane, and seaplane. 3. Type. As used with respect to the certification, ratings, privileges, and limitations of airmen, Type means a specific make and basic model of aircraft, including modifications thereto that do not change its handling or flight characteristics. Examples include 737-700, G4, and 1900. As used with respect to the certification of aircraft, means those aircraft which are similar in design. Examples include 737-700 and 737-700C, G4 and G4X, and 1900 and 1900C. This system of definitions allows the FAA to group and regulate aircraft to provide for their safe operation. Pilot certifications. The type of intended flying influences what type of pilot's certificate is required. Eligibility, training, experience, and testing requirements differ depending on the type of certificate sought. Each type of pilot certificate has privileges and limitations that are inherent within the certificate itself. However, other privileges and limitations may be applicable based on the aircraft type, operation being conducted, and the type of certificate. For example, a certain certificate may have privileges and limitations under 14 CFR Part 61 and Part 91. Privileges define where and when the pilot may fly, with whom they may fly, the purpose of the flight, and the type of aircraft they are allowed to fly. On the other hand, the FAA may impose limitations on a pilot certificate if, during training or the practical test, the pilot does not demonstrate all skills necessary to exercise all privileges of a privilege level, category, class, or type rating. Endorsements, a form of authorization, are written to establish that the certificate holder has received training in specific skill areas. Endorsements are written and signed by an authorized individual, usually a certificated flight instructor, CFI, and are based on aircraft classification. Sport pilot. To become a sport pilot, the student pilot is required to have flown a minimum number of hours depending on the aircraft. For airplanes, 20 hours. For powered parachutes, 12 hours. For weight shift control, trikes, 20 hours. For gliders, 10 hours. For rotorcraft, gyroplanes only, 20 hours. And for lighter than air, 20 hours for an airship or 7 hours for a balloon. To earn a sport pilot certificate, one must be at least 16 years old to become a student sport pilot, 14 years old for gliders or balloons, be at least 17 years old to test for a sport pilot certificate, 16 years old for gliders or balloons, be able to read, write, and understand the English language, and hold a current and valid driver's license as evidence of medical eligibility. When operating as a sport pilot, some of these privileges and limitations may apply. Privileges. Operate as pilot in command, PIC, of a light sport aircraft. Carry a passenger and share expenses, fuel, oil, airport expenses, and aircraft rental. And fly during the daytime using VFR. A minimum of 3 statute miles visibility and visual contact with the ground are required. Limitations. Prohibited from flying in Class A airspace. Prohibited from flying in Class B, C, or D airspace until you receive training and a logbook endorsement from an instructor. No flights outside the United States without prior permission from the Foreign Aviation Authority. May not tow any object. No flights while carrying a passenger or property for compensation or hire. And prohibited from flying in furtherance of a business. The Sport Pilot Certificate does not list aircraft category and class ratings. After successfully passing the practical test for a sport pilot certificate, regardless of the light sport aircraft privileges you seek, the FAA will issue you a sport pilot certificate without any category and class ratings. The instructor will provide you with the appropriate logbook endorsement for the category and class of aircraft in which you are authorized to act as pilot in command. Recreational pilot. To become a recreational pilot, one must be at least 17 years old, be able to read, write, speak, and understand the English language, pass the required knowledge test, meet the aeronautical experience requirements in either a single-engine airplane, a helicopter, or a gyroplane, obtain a logbook endorsement from an instructor, pass the required practical test, and obtain a third-class medical certificate issued under 14 CFR Part 67. As a recreational pilot, cross-country flight is limited to a 50 nm range from the departure airport, but is permitted with additional training per 14 CFR Part 61. Additionally, recreational pilots are restricted from flying at night and flying in airspace where communications with ATC are required. The minimum aeronautical experience requirements for a recreational pilot license involve 30 hours of flight time, including at least 15 hours of dual instruction, 2 hours of en route training, 3 hours in preparation for the practical test, and 3 hours of solo flight. When operating as a recreational pilot, some of these privileges and limitations may apply. Privileges: carry no more than one passenger, and not pay less than the pro-rata share of the operating expenses of a flight with a passenger, provided the expenses involve only fuel, oil, airport expenses, or aircraft rental fees. Limitations: a recreational pilot may not act as PIC of an aircraft that is certificated for more than four occupants or has more than one power plant. Private pilot: a private pilot is one who flies for pleasure or personal business without accepting compensation for flying, except in some very limited, specific circumstances. The private pilot certificate is the certificate held by the majority of active pilots. It allows command of any aircraft, subject to appropriate ratings, for any non-commercial purpose, and gives almost unlimited authority to fly under VFR. Passengers may be carried, and flight in furtherance of a business is permitted. However, a private pilot may not be compensated in any way for services as a pilot, although passengers can pay a pro-rata share of flight expenses, such as fuel or rental costs. If training under 14 CFR Part 61, experience requirements include at least 40 hours of piloting time, including 20 hours of flight with an instructor and 10 hours of solo flight. Commercial pilot: a commercial pilot may be compensated for flying. Training for the certificate focuses on a better understanding of aircraft systems and a higher standard of airmanship. The commercial pilot certificate itself does not allow a pilot to fly in instrument meteorological conditions, IMC, and commercial pilots without an instrument rating are restricted to daytime flight within 50 nm when flying for hire. A commercial airplane pilot must be able to operate a complex airplane, as a specific number of hours of complex or turbine-powered aircraft time are among the prerequisites, and at least a portion of the practical examination is performed in a complex aircraft. A complex aircraft must have retractable landing gear, movable flaps, and a controllable pitch propeller. Airline transport pilot: the airline transport pilot, ATP, is tested to the highest level of piloting ability. The ATP certificate is a prerequisite for serving as a PIC and second-in-command, SIC, of scheduled airline operations. It is also a prerequisite for serving as a PIC in select charter and fractional operations. The minimum pilot experience is 1,500 hours of flight time. In addition, the pilot must be at least 23 years of age, be able to read, write, speak, and understand the English language, and be of good moral standing. A pilot may obtain an ATP certificate with restricted privileges enabling him or her to serve as an SIC in scheduled airline operations. The minimum pilot experience is reduced based upon specific academic and flight training experience. The minimum age to be eligible is 21 years. Selecting a flight school. Selecting a flight school is an important consideration in the flight training process. FAA-approved training centers, FAA-approved pilot schools, non-certificated flying schools, and independent flight instructors conduct flight training in the United States. All flight training is conducted under the auspices of the FAA, following the regulations outlined in 14 CFR, Parts 142, 141, or 61. Training centers, also referred to as flight academies, operate under 14 CFR, Part 142, and are certificated by the FAA. Application for certification is voluntary, and the training center must meet stringent requirements for personnel, equipment, maintenance facilities, and must teach a curriculum approved by the FAA. Training centers typically utilize a number of flight simulation training devices as part of its curricula. Flight training conducted at a training center is primarily done under contract to airlines and other commercial operators in transport or turbine aircraft. However, many also provide flight training for the private pilot certificate, commercial pilot certificate, instrument rating, and ATP certificate. Flight schools operating under 14 CFR Part 141 are certificated by the FAA. Application for certification is voluntary, and the school must meet stringent requirements for personnel, equipment, maintenance, facilities, and must teach an established curriculum, which includes a training course outline, TCO, approved by the FAA. The certificated schools may qualify for a ground school rating and a flight school rating. In addition, the school may be authorized to give its graduates practical flight tests and knowledge computer-administered written tests. The FAA Pilot School Search Database, located at faa.gov, lists certificated ground and flight schools and the pilot training courses each school offers. Enrollment in a 14 CFR Part 141 flight school ensures quality, continuity, and offers a structured approach to flight training because these facilities must document the training curriculum and have their flight courses approved by the FAA. These strictures allow 14 CFR Part 141 schools to complete certificates and ratings in fewer flight hours, which can mean a savings on the cost of flight training for the student pilot. For example, the minimum requirement for a private pilot certificate is 35 hours in a Part 141 certificated school and 40 hours in a Part 61 certificated school. This difference may be insignificant for a private pilot certificate because the national average indicates most pilots require 60 to 75 hours of flight training. Many excellent flight schools find it impractical to qualify for the FAA Part 141 certificates and are referred to as Part 61 schools. 14 CFR Part 61 outlines certificate and rating requirements for pilot certification through non-certificated schools and individual flight instructors. It also states what knowledge-based training must be covered and how much flight experience is required for each certificate and rating. Flight schools and flight instructors who train must adhere to the statutory requirements and train pilots to the standards found in 14 CFR Part 61. One advantage of flight training under 14 CFR Part 61 is its flexibility. Flight lessons can be tailored to the individual student, because 14 CFR Part 61 dictates the required minimum flight experience and knowledge-based training necessary to gain a specific pilot's license, but it does not stipulate how the training is to be organized. This flexibility can also be a disadvantage, because a flight instructor who fails to organize the flight training can cost a student pilot time and expense through repetitious training. One way for a student pilot to avoid this problem is to ensure the flight instructor has a well-documented training syllabus. How to find a reputable flight program. To obtain information about pilot training, contact the local FISDO, which maintains a current file on all schools within its district. The choice of a flight school depends on what type of certificate is sought and whether an individual wishes to fly as a sport pilot or wishes to pursue a career as a professional pilot. Another consideration is the amount of time that can be devoted to training. Ground and flight training should be obtained as regularly and frequently as possible, because this assures maximum retention of instruction and the achievement of requisite proficiency. Do not make the determination based on financial concerns alone, because the quality of training is very important. Prior to making a final decision, visit the schools under consideration and talk with management, instructors, and students. Request a personal tour of the flight school facility. Be inquisitive and proactive when searching for a flight school. Do some homework and develop a checklist of questions by talking to pilots and reading articles in flight magazines. The checklist should include questions about aircraft reliability and maintenance practices and questions for current students, such as whether or not there is a safe, clean aircraft available when they are scheduled to fly. Questions for the training facility should be aimed at determining if the instruction fits available personal time. What are the school's operating hours? Does the facility have dedicated classrooms available for ground training required by the FAA? Is there an area available for pre-flight briefings, post-flight debriefings, and critiques? Are these rooms private in nature in order to provide a non-threatening environment in which the instructor can explain the content and outcome of the flight without making the student feel self-conscious? Examine the facility before committing to any flight training. Evaluate the answers on the checklist, and then take time to think things over before making a decision. This proactive approach to choosing a flight school will ensure student pilot contracts with a flight school or flight instructor best suited to their individual needs. How to choose a certificated flight instructor. Whether an individual chooses to train under 14 CFR Part 141 or Part 61, the key to an effective flight program is the quality of the ground and flight training received from the certified flight instructor, CFI. The flight instructor assumes total responsibility for training an individual to meet the standards required for certification within an ever-changing operating environment. A CFI should possess an understanding of the learning process, knowledge of the fundamentals of teaching, and the ability to communicate effectively with the student pilot. During the certification process, a flight instructor applicant is tested on the practical application of these skills in specific teaching situations. The flight instructor is crucial to the scenario-based training program endorsed by the FAA. He or she is trained to function in the learning environment as an advisor and guide for the learner. The duties, responsibilities, and authority of the CFI include orienting the student to the scenario-based training system, helping the student become a confident planner and in-flight manager of each flight and a critical evaluator of their own performance, helping the student understand the knowledge requirements present in real-world applications, diagnosing learning difficulties and help the student overcome them, evaluating student progress and maintaining appropriate records, and providing continuous review of student learning. Should a student pilot find the selected CFI is not training in a manner conducive for learning, or the student and CFI do not have compatible schedules, the student pilot should find another CFI. Choosing the right CFI is important because the quality of instruction and the knowledge and skills acquired from their flight instructor affect a student pilot's entire flying career. The student pilot. The first step in becoming a pilot is to select a type of aircraft. FAA rules for obtaining a pilot certificate differ depending on the type of aircraft flown. Individuals can choose among airplanes, gyroplanes, weight shift, helicopters, powered parachutes, gliders, balloons, or airships. A pilot does not need a certificate to fly ultralight vehicles. Basic requirements. A student pilot is one who is being trained by an instructor pilot for his or her first full certificate and is permitted to fly alone, solo, under specific, limited circumstances. Before a student pilot may be endorsed to fly solo, that student must have a student pilot certificate. There are multiple ways that an aspiring pilot can obtain their student pilot certificate. The application may be processed by an FAA inspector or technician, an FAA-designated pilot examiner, a certified flight instructor, or an Airman Certification Representative, ACR. If the application is completed electronically, the authorized person will submit the application to the FAA's Airman Certification Branch, AFS 760, in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, via the Integrated Airman Certification and Rating Application, IACRA. If the application is completed on paper, it must be sent to the local Flight Standards District Office, FISDO, who will forward it to AFS 760. Once the application is processed, the applicant will receive the student pilot certificate by mail at the address provided on the application. The new certificate will be printed on a plastic card, which will replace the paper certificate that was issued in the past. The plastic card certificate will not have an expiration date. Paper certificates issued prior to the new process will still expire according to the date on the certificate. However, under the new process, paper certificates cannot be renewed. Once the paper certificate expires, the student pilot must submit a new application under the new process. Another significant change in the new process is that flight instructors will now make endorsements for solo privileges in the student pilot's logbook instead of endorsing the student pilot certificate. To be eligible for a student pilot certificate, the applicant must be at least 16 years of age, 14 years of age to pilot a glider or balloon, and be able to read, speak, write, and understand the English language. Medical certification requirements. The second step in becoming a pilot is to obtain a medical certificate, if the choice of aircraft is an airplane, helicopter, gyroplane, or an airship. The FAA suggests the individual get a medical certificate before beginning flight training to avoid the expense of flight training that cannot be continued due to a medical condition. Balloon or glider pilots do not need a medical certificate, but do need to write a statement certifying that no medical defect exists that would prevent them from piloting a balloon or glider. The new sport pilot category does not require a medical examination. A driver's license can be used as proof of medical competence. Applicants who fail to meet certain requirements or who have physical disabilities which might limit but not prevent their acting as pilots should contact the nearest FAA office. Anyone requesting an FAA medical clearance, medical certificate, or student pilot medical certificate can electronically complete an application through the FAA's MedExpress system, available at medexpress.faa.gov. A medical certificate is obtained by passing a physical examination administered by a doctor who is an FAA-authorized AME. There are approximately 6,000 FAA-authorized AMEs in the nation. To find an AME near you, go to the FAA's AME locator at faa.gov/pilots/AME locator. Medical certificates are designated as first class, second class, or third class. Generally, first class is designed for the airline transport pilot, second class for the commercial pilot, and third class for the student, recreational, and private pilot. A student pilot certificate can be processed by an FAA inspector or technician, an FAA-designated pilot examiner, DPE, an Airman Certification Representative, ACR, or a Certified Flight Instructor, CFI. This certificate allows an individual who is being trained by a flight instructor to fly alone, solo, under specific, limited circumstances, and must be carried with the student pilot while exercising solo flight privileges. The student pilot certificate is only required when exercising solo flight privileges. The new plastic student certificate does not have an expiration date. For airmen who are issued a paper certificate, that certificate will remain valid until its expiration date. A paper certificate cannot be renewed. When the paper certificate expires, a new application must be completed via the IACRA system, and a new plastic certificate will be issued. Student pilot solo requirements. Once a student has accrued sufficient training and experience, a CFI can endorse the student's logbook to authorize limited solo flight in a specific type, make and model, of aircraft. A student pilot may not carry passengers, fly in furtherance of a business, or operate an aircraft outside of the various endorsements provided by the flight instructor. There is no minimum aeronautical knowledge or experience requirement for the issuance of a student pilot certificate. However, the applicant must be at least 16 years of age, 14 years of age for those piloting a glider or balloon, and they must be able to read, speak, write, and understand the English language. There are, however, minimum aeronautical knowledge and experience requirements for student pilots to solo. Becoming a pilot. The course of instruction a student pilot follows depends on the type of certificate sought. It should include the ground and flight training necessary to acquire the knowledge and skills required to safely and efficiently function as a certificated pilot in the selected category and class of aircraft. The specific knowledge and skill areas for each category and class of aircraft are outlined in 14 CFR Part 61. Eligibility, aeronautical knowledge, proficiency, and aeronautical requirements can be found in 14 CFR Part 61, Subpart D for recreational pilots, Subpart E for private pilots, and Subpart J for sport pilots. The knowledge-based portion of training is obtained through FAA handbooks such as this one, textbooks, and other sources of training and testing materials, which are available in print form from the Superintendent of Documents, GPO, and online at FAA.gov's Regulatory Support Division. The CFI may also use commercial publications as a source of study materials, especially for aircraft categories where government materials are limited. A student pilot should follow the flight instructor's advice on what and when to study. Planning a definite study program and following it as closely as possible will help in scoring well on the knowledge test. Haphazard or disorganized study habits usually result in an unsatisfactory score. In addition to learning aeronautical knowledge, such as the principles of flight, a student pilot is also required to gain skill in flight maneuvers. The selected category and class of aircraft determines the type of flight skills and number of flight hours to be obtained. There are four steps involved in learning a flight maneuver. The CFI introduces and demonstrates the flight maneuver to the student. The CFI talks the student pilot through the maneuver. The student pilot practices the maneuver under the CFI's supervision. And the CFI authorizes the student pilot to practice the maneuver solo. Once the student pilot has shown proficiency in the required knowledge areas, flight maneuvers, and accrued the required amount of flight hours, the CFI endorses the student pilot logbook, which allows the student pilot to take the written and practical tests for pilot certification. Knowledge and skill tests. Knowledge tests. The knowledge test is the computer portion of the tests taken to obtain pilot certification. The test contains questions of the objective multiple choice type. This testing method conserves the applicant's time, eliminates any element of individual judgment in determining grades, and saves time in scoring. FAA Airman Knowledge Test Guides for every type of pilot certificate address most questions you may have regarding the knowledge test process. The guides are available online, free of charge, at faa.gov. When to take the knowledge test. The knowledge test is more meaningful to the applicant and more likely to result in a satisfactory grade if it is taken after beginning the flight portion of the training. Therefore, the FAA recommends the knowledge test be taken after the student pilot has completed a solo cross-country flight. The operational knowledge gained by this experience can be used to the student's advantage in the knowledge test. The student pilot's CFI is the best person to determine when the applicant is ready to take the knowledge test. Practical test. The FAA has developed PTS for FAA pilot certificates and associated ratings. In 2015, the FAA began transitioning to the ACS approach. The ACS is essentially an enhanced version of the PTS. It adds task-specific knowledge and risk management elements to each PTS area of operation and task. The result is a holistic, integrated presentation of specific knowledge, skills, and risk management elements and performance metrics for each area of operation and task. The ACS evaluation program will eventually replace the PTS program for evaluating and certifying pilots. The practical tests are administered by FAA ASIs and DPEs. Title 14 CFR Part 61 specifies the areas of operation in which knowledge and skill must be demonstrated by the applicant. Since the FAA requires all practical tests be conducted in accordance with the appropriate PTS and the policies set forth in the introduction section of the PTS book, the pilot applicant should become familiar with this book during training. The PTS book is a testing document and not intended to be a training syllabus. An appropriately rated flight instructor is responsible for training the pilot applicant to acceptable standards in all subject matter areas, procedures, and maneuvers. Descriptions of tasks and information on how to perform maneuvers and procedures are contained in reference and teaching documents, such as this handbook. A list of reference documents is contained in the introduction section of each PTS book. Copies may be obtained by downloading from the FAA website or purchasing print copies from the GPO in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, or via their official online bookstore at www.access.gpo.gov. The flight proficiency maneuvers listed in 14 CFR Part 61 are the standard skill requirements for certification. They are outlined in the PTS as areas of operation. These are phases of the practical test arranged in a logical sequence within the standard. They begin with pre-flight preparation and end with post-flight procedures. Each area of operation contains tasks, which are comprised of knowledge areas, flight procedures, and flight maneuvers appropriate to the area of operation. The candidate is required to demonstrate knowledge and proficiency in all tasks for the original issuance of all pilot certificates. When to take the practical test. 14 CFR Part 61 establishes the ground school and flight experience requirements for the type of certification and aircraft selected. However, the CFI best determines when an applicant is qualified for the practical test. A practice practical test is an important step in the flight training process. The applicant will be asked to present FAA Form 8710-1 or 871.11 for sport applicants, the application for an airman certificate or rating with the flight instructor's recommendation, an airman knowledge test report with a satisfactory grade, a medical certificate, not required for glider or balloon pilots, a student pilot certificate, and a pilot logbook endorsed by a flight instructor for solo and solo cross-country, airplane and rotorcraft, and for the make and model aircraft to be used for the practical test, driver's license or medical certificate for sport pilot applicants, the pilot logbook records, and a graduation certificate from an FAA-approved school, if applicable. The applicant must provide an airworthy aircraft with equipment relevant to the areas of operation required for the practical test. He or she will also be asked to produce and explain the aircraft's registration certificate, aircraft's airworthiness certificate, aircraft's operating limitations or FAA-approved aircraft flight manual if required, aircraft equipment list, required weight and balance data, maintenance records, and applicable airworthiness directives, ADs. For a detailed explanation of the required pilot maneuvers and performance standards, refer to the PTS pertaining to the type of certification and aircraft selected. These standards may be downloaded free of charge from the FAA website. They may also be purchased from the Superintendent of Documents or GPO bookstores. Most airport fixed base operators and flight schools carry a variety of government publications and charts, as well as commercially published materials. Who administers the FAA practical tests? Due to the varied responsibilities of the FISDOs, practical tests are usually given by DPEs. An applicant should schedule the practical test by appointment to avoid conflicts and wasted time. A list of examiner names can be obtained from the local FISDO. Since a DPE serves without pay from the government for conducting practical tests and processing the necessary reports, the examiner is allowed to charge a reasonable fee. There is no charge for the practical test when conducted by an FAA inspector. Role of the certificated flight instructor. To become a CFI, a pilot must meet the provisions of 14 CFR Part 61. The FAA places full responsibility for student flight training on the shoulders of the CFI, who is the cornerstone of aviation safety. It is the job of the flight instructor to train the student pilot in all the knowledge areas and teach the skills necessary for the student pilot to operate safely and competently as a certificated pilot in the NAS. The training includes airmanship skills, pilot judgment and decision-making, and good operating practices. a pilot training program depends on the quality of the ground and flight instruction the student pilot receives. The flight instructor must possess a thorough understanding of the learning process, knowledge of the fundamentals of teaching, and the ability to communicate effectively with the student pilot. Use of a structured training program and formal course syllabus is crucial for effective and comprehensive flight training. It should be clear to the student in advance of every lesson what the course of training will involve and the criteria for successful completion. This should include the flight instructor briefing and debriefing the student before and after every lesson. Additionally, scenario-based training has become the preferred method of flight instruction today. This involves presenting the student with realistic flight scenarios and recommended actions for mitigating risk. Insistence on correct techniques and procedures from the beginning of training by the flight instructor ensures that the student pilot develops proper flying habits. Any deficiencies in the maneuvers or techniques must immediately be emphasized and corrected. A flight instructor serves as a role model for the student pilot who observes the flying habits of his or her flight instructor during flight instruction, as well as when the instructor conducts other pilot operations. Thus, the flight instructor becomes a model of flying proficiency for the student who, consciously or unconsciously, attempts to imitate the instructor. For this reason, a flight instructor should observe recognized safety practices, as well as regulations, during all flight operations. The student pilot who enrolls in a pilot training program commits considerable time, effort, and expense to achieve a pilot certificate. Students often judge the effectiveness of the flight instructor and the success of the pilot training program based on their ability to pass the requisite FAA practical test. A competent flight instructor stresses to the student that practical tests are a sampling of pilot ability compressed into a short period of time. The goal of a flight instructor is to train the total pilot. Role of the Designated Pilot Examiner. The Designated Pilot Examiner, DPE, plays an important role in the FAA's mission of promoting aviation safety by administering FAA practical tests for pilot and flight instructor certificates and associated ratings. Although administering these tests is a responsibility of the ASI, the FAA's highest priority is making air travel safer by inspecting aircraft that fly in the United States. To satisfy the need for pilot testing and certification services, the FAA delegates certain responsibilities to private individuals who are not FAA employees. Appointed in accordance with 14 CFR Part 183, a DPE is an individual who meets the qualification requirements of the Pilot Examiner's Handbook, FAA Order 8710.3, and who is technically qualified, holds all pertinent category, class, and type ratings for each aircraft related to their designation, meets the requirements of 14 CFR Part 61 as appropriate, is current and qualified to act as PIC of each aircraft for which he or she is authorized, maintains at least a third-class medical certificate if required, and maintains a current flight instructor certificate if required. Designated to perform specific pilot certification tasks on behalf of the FAA, a DPE may charge a reasonable fee. Generally, a DPE's authority is limited to accepting applications and conducting practical tests leading to the issuance of specific pilot certificates and ratings. The majority of FAA practical tests at the private and commercial pilot levels are administered by DPEs. DPE candidates must have good industry reputations for professionalism, integrity, a demonstrated willingness to serve the public, and must adhere to FAA policies and procedures in certification matters. The FAA expects the DPE to administer practical tests with the same degree of professionalism, using the same methods, procedures, and standards as an FAA ASI. Chapter Summary. The FAA has entered the second century of civil aviation as a robust government organization and is taking full advantage of technology such as global positioning system, GPS, satellite technology to enhance the safety of civil aviation. The internet has also become an important tool in promoting aviation safety and providing around-the-clock resources for the aviation community. Handbooks, regulations, standards, references, and online courses are now available at www.faa.gov. In keeping with the FAA's belief that safety is a learned behavior, the FAA offers many courses and seminars to enhance air safety. The FAA puts the burden of instilling safe flying habits on the flight instructor, who should follow basic flight safety practices and procedures in every flight operation he or she undertakes with a student pilot. Operational safety practices include, but are not limited to, collision avoidance procedures consisting of proper scanning techniques, use of checklists, runway incursion avoidance, positive transfer of controls, and workload management. These safety practices are discussed more fully within this handbook. Safe flight also depends on scenario-based training, SBT, that teaches the student pilot how to respond in different flight situations. The FAA has incorporated these techniques along with decision-making methods such as aeronautical decision-making, ADM, risk management, and crew resource management, CRM, which are covered more completely in the next chapter. Chapter 2. Aeronautical Decision-Making. Aeronautical decision-making, ADM, is decision-making in a unique environment, aviation. It is a systematic approach to the mental process used by pilots to consistently determine the best course of action in response to a given set of circumstances. It is what a pilot intends to do based on the latest information he or she has. The importance of learning and understanding effective ADM skills cannot be overemphasized. While progress is continually being made in the advancement of pilot training methods, aircraft equipment and systems, and services for pilots, accidents still occur. Despite all the changes in technology to improve flight safety, one factor remains the same, the human factor, which leads to errors. It is estimated that approximately 80% of all aviation accidents are related to human factors, and the vast majority of these accidents occur during landing, 24.1%, and takeoff, 23.4%. ADM is a systematic approach to risk assessment and stress management. To understand ADM is to also understand how personal attitudes can influence decision-making and how those attitudes can be modified to enhance safety in the flight deck. It is important to understand the factors that cause humans to make decisions and how the decision-making process not only works but can be improved. This chapter focuses on helping the pilot improve his or her ADM skills with the goal of mitigating the risk factors associated with flight. Advisory Circular, AC 6022, Aeronautical Decision-Making, provides background references, definitions, and other pertinent information about ADM training in the general aviation, GA, environment. History of ADM. For over 25 years, the importance of good pilot judgment, or aeronautical decision-making, ADM, has been recognized as critical to the safe operation of aircraft, as well as accident avoidance. The airline industry, motivated by the need to reduce accidents caused by human factors, developed the first training programs based on improving ADM. Crew Resource Management, CRM, training for flight crews is focused on the effective use of all available resources, human resources, hardware, and information supporting ADM to facilitate crew cooperation and improve decision-making. The goal of all flight crews is good ADM, and the use of CRM is one way to make good decisions. Research in this area prompted the Federal Aviation Administration, FAA, to produce training directed at improving the decision-making of pilots and led to current FAA regulations that require that decision-making be taught as part of the pilot training curriculum. ADM research, development, and testing culminated in 1987. With the publication of 6 manuals oriented to the decision-making needs of variously rated pilots. These manuals provided multifaceted materials designed to reduce the number of decision-related accidents. The effectiveness of these materials was validated in independent studies, where student pilots received such training in conjunction with the standard flying curriculum. When tested, the pilots who had received ADM training made fewer in-flight errors than those who had not received ADM training. The differences were statistically significant and ranged from about 10 to 50% fewer judgment errors. In the operational environment, an operator flying about 400,000 hours annually demonstrated a 54% reduction in accident rate after using these materials for recurrency training. Contrary to popular opinion, good judgment can be taught. Tradition held that good judgment was a natural byproduct of experience. But as pilots continued to log accident-free flight hours, a corresponding increase of good judgment was assumed. Building upon the foundation of conventional decision-making, ADM enhances the process to decrease the probability of human error and increase the probability of a safe flight. ADM provides a structured, systematic approach to analyzing changes that occur during a flight and how these changes might affect the safe outcome of a flight. The ADM process addresses all aspects of decision-making in the flight deck and identifies the steps involved in good decision-making. 1. Identifying personal attitudes hazardous to safe flight. 2. Learning behavior modification techniques. 3. Learning how to recognize and cope with stress. 4. Developing risk assessment skills. 5, using all resources, and 6, evaluating the effectiveness of one's ADM skills. Risk management. The goal of risk management is to proactively identify safety-related hazards and mitigate the associated risks. Risk management is an important component of ADM. When a pilot follows good decision-making practices, the inherent risk in a flight is reduced or even eliminated. The ability to make good decisions is based upon direct or indirect experience and education. The formal risk management decision-making process involves these 6 steps. 1. Identify hazards. 2. Assess risks. 3. Analyze controls. 4. Make controlled decisions. 5. Use controls. And 6. Monitor results. Consider automotive seatbelt use. In just 2 decades, seatbelt use has become the norm, placing those who do not wear seatbelts outside the norm. But this group may learn to wear a seatbelt by either direct or indirect experience. For example, a driver learns through direct experience about the value of wearing a seatbelt when he or she is involved in a car accident that leads to a personal injury. An indirect learning experience occurs when a loved one is injured during a car accident because he or she failed to wear a seatbelt. As you work through the ADM cycle, it is important to remember the 4 fundamental principles of risk management. 1. Accept no unnecessary risk. Flying is not possible without risk, but unnecessary risk comes without a corresponding return. If you are flying a new airplane for the first time, you might determine that the risk of making that flight in low visibility conditions is unnecessary. 2. Make risk decisions at the appropriate level. Risk decisions should be made by the person who can develop and implement risk controls. Remember that you are pilot in command, so never let anyone else, not air traffic control and not your passengers, make risk decisions for you. 3. Accept risk when benefits outweigh dangers, costs. In any flying activity, it is necessary to accept some degree of risk. A day with good weather, for example, is a much better time to fly an unfamiliar airplane for the first time than a day with low IFR conditions. And 4, integrate risk management into planning at all levels. Because risk is an unavoidable part of every flight, safety requires the use of appropriate and effective risk management, not just in the pre-flight planning stage, but in all stages of the flight. While poor decision-making in everyday life does not always lead to tragedy, the margin for error in aviation is thin. Since ADM enhances management of an aeronautical environment, all pilots should become familiar with and employ ADM. Crew Resource Management, CRM, and Single Pilot Resource Management. While CRM focuses on pilots operating in crew environments, many of the concepts apply to single pilot operations. Many CRM principles have been successfully applied to single pilot aircraft and led to the development of Single Pilot Resource Management, SRM. SRM is defined as the art and science of managing all the resources, both onboard the aircraft and from outside sources, available to a single pilot, prior to and during flight, to ensure the successful outcome of the flight. SRM includes the concepts of ADM, risk management, RM, task management, TM, automation management, AM, controlled flight into terrain, CFIT, awareness, and situational awareness, SA. SRM training helps the pilot maintain situational awareness by managing the automation and associated aircraft control and navigation tasks. This enables the pilot to accurately assess and manage risk and make accurate and timely decisions. SRM is all about helping pilots learn how to gather information, analyze it, and make decisions. Although the flight is coordinated by a single person and not an onboard flight crew, the use of available resources, such as autopilot and air traffic control, ATC, replicates the principles of CRM. Hazard and risk. 2 defining elements of ADM are hazard and risk. Hazard is a real or perceived condition, event, or circumstance that a pilot encounters. When faced with a hazard, the pilot makes an assessment of that hazard based upon various factors. The pilot assigns a value to the potential impact of the hazard, which qualifies the pilot's assessment of the hazard, risk. Therefore, risk is an assessment of the single or cumulative hazard facing a pilot. However, different pilots see hazards differently. For example, the pilot arrives to preflight and discovers a small, blunt-type nick in the leading edge at the middle of the aircraft's prop. Since the aircraft is parked on the tarmac, the nick was probably caused by another aircraft's prop wash blowing some type of debris into the propeller. The nick is the hazard, a present condition, The risk is prop fracture if the engine is operated with damage to a prop blade. The seasoned pilot may see the nick as a low risk. He realizes this type of nick diffuses stress over a large area, is located in the strongest portion of the propeller, and based on experience, he does not expect it to propagate a crack that can lead to high-risk problems. He does not cancel his flight. The inexperienced pilot may see the nick as a high-risk factor because he is unsure of the effect the nick will have on the operation of the prop, and he has been told that damage to a prop could cause a catastrophic failure. This assessment leads him to cancel his flight. Therefore, elements or factors affecting individuals are different and profoundly impact decision-making. These are called human factors and can transcend education, experience, health, physiological aspects, and so on. Another example of risk assessment was the flight of a Beechcraft King Air equipped with de-icing and anti-icing. The pilot deliberately flew into moderate to severe icing conditions while ducking under cloud cover. A prudent pilot would assess the risk as high and beyond the capabilities of the aircraft. Yet this pilot did the opposite. Why did the pilot take this action? Past experience prompted the action. The pilot had successfully flown into these conditions repeatedly, although the icing conditions were previously forecast 2,000 feet above the surface. This time, the conditions were forecast from the surface. Since the pilot was in a hurry and failed to factor in the difference between the forecast altitudes, he assigned a low risk to the hazard and took a chance. He and the passengers died from a poor risk assessment of the situation. Hazardous attitudes and antidotes. Being fit to fly depends on more than just a pilot's physical condition and recent experience. For example, attitude affects the quality of decisions. Attitude is a motivational predisposition to respond to people, situations, or events in a given manner. Studies have identified 5 hazardous attitudes that can interfere with the ability to make sound decisions and exercise authority properly: anti-authority, impulsivity, invulnerability, macho, and resignation. The anti-authority attitude is found in people who do not like anyone telling them what to do. They may be resentful of having someone tell them what to do, or may regard rules, regulations, and procedures as silly or unnecessary. Keep in mind, however, that it is always your prerogative to question authority if you feel it is an error. The antidote to the anti-authority attitude is to follow the rules. They are usually right. Impulsivity is the attitude of people who frequently feel the need to do something, anything, immediately. They do not stop to think about what they are about to do. They do not select the best alternative, and they do the first thing that comes to mind. The antidote to the impulsivity attitude is to not react so quickly. Think first. People with an attitude of invulnerability falsely believe that accidents happen to others, but never to them. They know accidents can happen, and they know that anyone can be affected. However, they never really feel or believe that they will be personally involved. Pilots who think this way are more likely to take chances and increase risk. The antidote to the invulnerability attitude is to be aware that accidents can happen to you. Pilots with a macho attitude are always trying to prove that they are better than anyone else, thinking things like, "I can do it, I'll show them." Pilots with this type of attitude will try to prove themselves by taking risks in order to impress others. While this pattern is thought to be a male characteristic, women are equally susceptible. The antidote to the macho attitude is realizing that taking chances is foolish. Pilots with an attitude of resignation often think, "What's the use?" and do not see themselves as being able to make a great deal of difference in what happens to them. When things go well, the pilot is apt to think that it is good luck. When things go badly, the pilot may feel that someone is out to get them, or attribute it to bad luck. The pilot will leave the action to others, for better or worse. Sometimes such pilots will even go along with unreasonable requests just to be a nice guy. The antidote to the resignation attitude is keeping in mind that you aren't helpless. You can make a difference. Hazardous attitudes contribute to poor pilot judgment, but can be effectively counteracted by redirecting the hazardous attitude so that correct action can be taken. Recognition of hazardous thoughts is the first step toward neutralizing them. After recognizing a thought as hazardous, the pilot should label it as hazardous, then state the corresponding antidote. Antidotes should be memorized for each of the hazardous attitudes so they automatically come to mind when needed. Risk. During each flight, the single pilot makes many decisions under hazardous conditions. To fly safely, the pilot needs to assess the degree of risk and determine the best course of action to mitigate the risk. Assessing risk. For the single pilot, assessing risk is not as simple as it sounds. For example, the pilot acts as his or her own quality control in making decisions. If a fatigued pilot who has flown 16 hours is asked if he or she is too tired to continue flying, the answer may be no. Most pilots are goal-oriented, and when asked to accept a flight, there is a tendency to deny personal limitations while adding weight to issues not germane to the mission. For example, pilots of helicopter emergency services, EMS, have been known, more than other groups, to make flight decisions that add significant weight to the patient's welfare. These pilots add weight to intangible factors, the patient in this case, and fail to appropriately quantify actual hazards, such as fatigue or weather, when making flight decisions. The single pilot, who has no other crew member for consultation, must wrestle with the intangible factors that draw one into a hazardous position. Therefore, he or she has a greater vulnerability than a full crew. Examining National Transportation Safety Board, NTSB, reports, and other accident research can help a pilot learn to assess risk more effectively. For example, the accident rate during night visual flight rules, VFR, decreases by nearly 50% once a pilot obtains 100 hours, and continues to decrease until the 1,000-hour level. The data suggest that for the first 500 hours, pilots flying VFR at night might want to establish higher personal limitations than are required by the regulations, and, if applicable, apply instrument flying skills in this environment. Several risk assessment models are available to assist in the process of assessing risk. The models, all taking slightly different approaches, seek a common goal of assessing risk in an objective manner. The most basic tool is the risk matrix. It assesses two items: the likelihood of an event occurring, along the y-axis of the matrix, and the severity or consequence of that event, along the x-axis of the matrix. Likelihood of an event. Likelihood, along the y-axis, is nothing more than taking a situation and determining the probability of its occurrence. From top to bottom, it is rated as probable, occasional, remote, or improbable. For example, a pilot is flying from point A to point B, 50 miles, in marginal visual flight rules, MVFR, conditions. The likelihood of encountering potential instrument meteorological conditions, IMC, is the first question the pilot needs to answer. The experiences of other pilots, coupled with the forecast, might cause the pilot to assign occasional to determine the probability of encountering IMC. Here are some guidelines for making assignments. Probable means an event will occur several times. Occasional means an event will probably occur sometime. Remote means an event is unlikely to occur but is possible, and improbable means an event is highly unlikely to occur. Severity of an event. The next element is the severity or consequence of a pilot's actions, along the x-axis. From left to right, it is rated as catastrophic, critical, marginal, or negligible, and can relate to injury or damage. If the individual in our example is not an instrument-rated pilot, what are the consequences of him or her encountering inadvertent IMC conditions? In this case, because the pilot is not IFR-rated, the consequences are catastrophic. Here are some guidelines for this assignment. Catastrophic consequences involve fatalities and total loss. Critical consequences involve severe injury and major damage. Marginal consequences involve minor injury and minor damage, and negligible consequences involve less than minor injury and less than minor system damage. The matrix connecting the two factors contains 16 squares, indicating four levels of risk. High risk, the three squares at the top left corner of the grid. Serious risk, the three squares forming a diagonal that flanks the high risk squares on the right and bottom. Medium risk, the seven squares covering most of the middle and bottom of the grid. And low risk, the final three squares along the right side of the grid, indicating negligible severity combined with either occasional, remote, or improbable likelihood. Going back to our example with the pilot flying 50 miles from point A to point B, we determined that the likelihood of IMC was occasional and the severity was catastrophic. According to the matrix, this is a high-risk situation, and so the pilot must either not fly or fly only after finding ways to mitigate, eliminate, or control the risk. Although the risk matrix provides a general viewpoint of a generic situation, a more comprehensive program can be made that is tailored to a pilot's flying. This program includes a wide array of aviation-related questions specific to the pilot, and they assess health, how do you feel, well-being, How is your day going? Fatigue, did you get enough sleep? Weather, how much visibility do you have? Time, is the flight scheduled for day or night? And flight planning. For example, are you in a rush to get off the ground? Did you verify weight and balance? And did you brief the passengers before liftoff? The different responses to each question are assigned a number, say 0 if the pilot has slept well, and 2 if he or she hasn't. And the numbers corresponding to the pilot's responses are added up to determine the level of risk. The overall risk range, for example, from not complex flight to exercise caution to area of concern, is representative of the actions that a pilot imposes upon himself or herself. Mitigating risk. Risk assessment is only part of the equation. After determining the level of risk, the pilot needs to mitigate the risk. For example, the pilot flying 50 miles from point A to point B in MVFR conditions has several ways to reduce risk. He or she can wait for the weather to improve to good visual flight rules, VFR conditions, take an instrument-rated pilot, delay the flight, cancel the flight, or drive. One of the best ways single pilots can mitigate risk is to use the I'm Safe, I-M-S-A-F-E, checklist to determine physical and mental readiness for flying. I stands for illness. Am I sick? Illness is an obvious pilot risk. M stands for medication. Am I taking any medicines that might affect my judgment or make me drowsy? S stands for stress. Am I under psychological pressure from the job? Do I have money, health, or family problems? Stress causes concentration and performance problems. While the regulations list medical conditions that require grounding, stress is not among them. The pilot should consider the effects of stress on performance. A stands for alcohol. Have I been drinking within 8 hours, within 24 hours? As little as 1 ounce of liquor, 1 bottle of beer, or 4 ounces of wine can impair flying skills. Alcohol also renders a pilot more susceptible to disorientation and hypoxia. F stands for fatigue. Am I tired and not adequately rested? Fatigue continues to be one of the most insidious hazards to flight safety, as it may not be apparent to a pilot until serious errors are made. And E stands for emotion. Am I emotionally upset? The PAVE checklist. Another way to mitigate risk is to perceive hazards. By incorporating the PAVE, P-A-V-E, checklist into pre-flight planning, the pilot divides the risks of flight into 4 categories. P for pilot in command, PIC, A for aircraft, V for environment, and E for external pressures, which form part of a pilot's decision-making process. With the PAVE checklist, pilots have a simple way to remember each category to examine for risk prior to each flight. Once a pilot identifies the risks of a flight, he or she needs to decide whether the risk, or combination of risks, can be managed safely and successfully. If not, make the decision to cancel the flight. If the pilot decides to continue with the flight, he or she should develop strategies to mitigate the risks. One way a pilot can control the risks is to set personal minimums for items in each risk category. These are limits unique to that individual pilot's current level of experience and proficiency. For example, the aircraft may have a maximum crosswind component of 15 knots listed in the aircraft flight manual, AFM, and the pilot has experience with 10 knots of direct crosswind. It could be unsafe to exceed a 10-knot crosswind component without additional training. Therefore, the 10-knot crosswind experience level is that pilot's personal limitation until additional training with a certificated flight instructor, CFI, provides the pilot with additional experience for flying in crosswinds that exceed 10 knots. One of the most important concepts that safe pilots understand is the difference between what is legal in terms of the regulations and what is smart or safe in terms of pilot experience and proficiency. P for pilot in command, PIC. The pilot is one of the risk factors in a flight. The pilot must continually make decisions about competency, condition of health, mental and emotional state, level of fatigue, and many other variables. He or she must ask, "Am I ready for this trip?" in terms of experience, recency, currency, physical, and emotional condition. The I'm Safe checklist provides the answers. For an example of pilot-related risk, consider this scenario. A pilot had only 4 hours of sleep the night before being asked by the boss to fly to a meeting in a city 750 miles away. The reported weather was marginal and not expected to improve. After assessing fitness as a pilot, the pilot decided that it would not be wise to make the flight. The boss was initially unhappy, but later convinced by the pilot that the risks involved were unacceptable. A for aircraft. A pilot will frequently base decisions on the evaluations of the aircraft, such as performance, equipment, or airworthiness. What limitations will the aircraft impose upon the trip? Here are some questions you might ask. Is this the right aircraft for the flight? Am I familiar with and current in this aircraft? Aircraft performance figures and the AFM are based on a brand new aircraft flown by a professional test pilot. Keep that in mind while assessing personal and aircraft performance. Is this aircraft equipped for the flight? Instruments, lights, are the navigation and communication equipment adequate? Can this aircraft use the runways available for the trip with an adequate margin of safety under the conditions to be flown? Can this aircraft carry the planned load? Can this aircraft operate at the altitudes needed for the trip? Does this aircraft have sufficient fuel capacity, with reserves, for trip legs planned? And does the fuel quantity delivered match the fuel quantity ordered? For an example of aircraft-related risk, consider this scenario. During a pre-flight, a pilot noticed a small amount of oil dripping from the bottom of the aircraft's cowling. Although the quantity of oil seemed insignificant at the time, the pilot decided to delay the takeoff and have a mechanic check the source of the oil. The pilot's good judgment was confirmed when the mechanic found that one of the oil cooler hose fittings was loose. V for environment. The environment encompasses many elements that are not pilot or airplane related. It can include such factors as weather, air traffic control, navigational aids, nav aids, terrain, takeoff and landing areas, and surrounding obstacles. Weather. The weather is a major environmental consideration, especially as it can change drastically over time and distance. Earlier, it was suggested pilots set their own personal minimums, especially when it comes to weather. Here are some points to consider as you evaluate the weather for a particular flight. What is the current ceiling and visibility? In mountainous terrain, consider having higher minimums for ceiling and visibility, particularly if the terrain is unfamiliar. Consider the possibility that the weather may be different than forecast. Have alternative plans and be ready and willing to divert should an unexpected change occur. Consider the winds at the airports being used and the strength of the crosswind component. If flying in mountainous terrain, consider whether there are strong winds aloft. Strong winds in mountainous terrain can cause severe turbulence and downdrafts and be very hazardous for aircraft, even when there is no other significant weather. Are there any thunderstorms present or forecast? If there are clouds, is there any icing, current, or forecast? What is the dew point spread and the current temperature at altitude? Can descent be made safely all along the route? Finally, if icing conditions are encountered, is the pilot experienced at operating the aircraft's de-icing or anti-icing equipment? Is this equipment in good condition and functional? For what icing conditions is the aircraft rated, if any? Terrain. Evaluation of terrain is another important component of analyzing the flight environment. To avoid terrain and obstacles, especially at night or in low visibility, determine safe altitudes in advance by using the altitudes shown on VFR and IFR charts during pre-flight planning. It is also beneficial to use maximum elevation figures, MEFs, and other easily obtainable data to minimize chances of an in-flight collision with terrain or obstacles. Airport. Find out what lights are available at the destination and alternate airports. VASI, PAPI, or ILS glide slope guidance. Is the terminal airport equipped with them? Are they working? Will the pilot need to use the radio to activate the airport lights? Check the notices to airmen, NOTAM, for closed runways or airports. Also look for runway or beacon lights out, nearby towers, and so on. Choose the flight route wisely. An engine failure gives the nearby airports supreme importance. Finally, it may be useful to note that if there are shorter or obstructed fields at the destination or alternate airports. Airspace. If the trip is over remote areas, ensure there is appropriate clothing, water, and survival gear on board in the event of a forced landing. Keep in mind that if the trip includes flying over water or unpopulated areas with the chance of losing visual reference to the horizon, the pilot must be prepared to fly IFR. Finally, be sure to check the airspace and any temporary flight restrictions, TFRs, along the route of flight. Nighttime. Night flying requires special consideration. Keep in mind that if the trip includes flying at night over water or unpopulated areas with the chance of losing visual reference to the horizon, the pilot must be prepared to fly IFR. Ask yourself, will the flight conditions allow a safe emergency landing at night? And be sure to perform pre-flight check of all aircraft lights, interior and exterior, for a night flight. You should also carry at least two flashlights, one for exterior pre-flight and a smaller one that can be dimmed and kept nearby. For an example of environment-related risk, consider this scenario. a pilot was landing a small airplane just after a heavy jet had departed a parallel runway. The pilot assumed that wake turbulence would not be a problem, since landings had been performed under similar circumstances. Due to a combination of prevailing winds and wake turbulence from the heavy jet drifting across the landing runway, however, the airplane made a hard landing. The pilot had made an error when assessing the flight environment. E for external pressures. External pressures are influences external to the flight that create a sense of pressure to complete a flight, often at the expense of safety. Keep in mind that when deciding whether to undertake or continue a flight as planned, it is worth asking why the flight is being made, how critical it is to maintain the schedule, and whether the trip is worth the risks. Here are some factors that can function as external pressures. Someone waiting at the airport for the flight's arrival. A passenger the pilot does not want to disappoint. The desire to demonstrate pilot qualifications. The desire to impress someone. Probably the two most dangerous words in aviation are, "Watch this." The desire to satisfy a specific personal goal, such as get-home-itis, get-there-itis, and let's-go-itis. The pilot's general goal completion orientation, and emotional pressure associated with acknowledging that skill and experience levels may be lower than a pilot would like them to be. Pride can be a powerful external factor. Managing external pressures. Management of external pressure is the single most important key to risk management because it is the one risk factor category that can cause a pilot to ignore all the other risk factors. External pressures put time-related pressure on the pilot and figure into a majority of accidents. The use of personal standard operating procedures, SOPs, is one way to manage external pressures. The goal is to supply a release for the external pressures of a flight. These procedures include, but are not limited to, allowing time on a trip for an extra fuel stop or to make an unexpected landing because of weather, having alternate plans for a late arrival or making backup airline reservations for must-be-there trips. For really important trips, planning to leave early enough so that there will still be time to drive to the destination if necessary. Advising those who are waiting at the destination that the arrival may be delayed. It is important to know how to notify them when delays are encountered. Managing passengers' expectations by making sure passengers know that they might not arrive on a firm schedule, and if they must arrive by a certain time, they should make alternative plans. And eliminating pressure to return home, even on a casual day flight, by carrying a small overnight kit containing prescriptions, contact lens solutions, toiletries, or other necessities on every flight. The key to managing external pressure is to be ready for and accept delays. Remember that people get delayed when traveling on airlines, driving a car, or taking a bus. The pilot's goal is to manage risk, not create hazards. For an example of risk related to external pressures, consider this scenario. On a ferry flight to deliver an airplane from the factory in marginal weather conditions, the pilot calculated the ground speed and determined that the airplane would arrive at the destination with only 10 minutes of fuel remaining. The pilot was determined to keep on schedule by trying to stretch the fuel supply instead of landing to refuel. After landing with low fuel state, the pilot realized that this could have easily resulted in an emergency landing in deteriorating weather conditions. This was a chance that was not worth taking to keep the planned schedule. Human factors. Why are human conditions, such as fatigue, complacency, and stress, so important in aviation? These conditions, along with many others, are called human factors. Human factors directly cause or contribute to many aviation accidents and have been documented as a primary contributor to more than 70% of aircraft accidents. Typically, human factor incidents or accidents are associated with flight operations, but recently have also become a major concern in aviation maintenance and air traffic management as well. Over the past several years, the FAA has made the study and research of human factors a top priority by working closely with engineers, pilots, mechanics, and ATC to apply the latest knowledge about human factors in an effort to help operators and maintainers improve safety and efficiency in their daily operations. Human factors science, or human factors technologies, is a multidisciplinary field incorporating contributions from psychology, engineering, industrial design, statistics, operations research, and anthropometry. It is a term that covers the science of understanding the properties of human capability, the application of this understanding to the design, development, and deployment of systems and services, and the art of ensuring successful application of human factor principles into all aspects of aviation, to include pilots, ATC, and aviation maintenance. Human factors is often considered synonymous with CRM, or Maintenance Resource Management, MRM. but is really much broader in both its knowledge base and scope. Human factors involves gathering research specific to certain situations, such as flight, maintenance, stress levels, and knowledge, about human abilities, limitations, and other characteristics, and applying it to tool design, machines, systems, tasks, jobs, and environments to produce safe, comfortable, and effective human use. The entire aviation community benefits greatly from human factors research and development, as it helps better understand how humans can most safely and efficiently perform their jobs and improve the tools and systems in which they interact. Human behavior. Studies of human behavior have tried to determine an individual's predisposition to taking risks and the level of an individual's involvement in accidents. In 1951, a study regarding injury-prone children was published by Elizabeth Meacham Fuller and Helen B. Baum of the University of Minnesota. The study was comprised of two separate groups of second-grade students. 55 students were considered accident repeaters, and 48 students had no accidents. Both groups were from the same school of 600, and their family demographics were similar. The accident-free group showed a superior knowledge of safety, was considered industrious and cooperative with others, but were not considered physically inclined. The accident repeater group had better gymnastic skills, was considered aggressive and impulsive, demonstrated rebellious behavior when under stress, were poor losers, and liked to be the center of attention. One interpretation of this data, an adult predisposition to injury stems from childhood behavior and environment, leads to the conclusion that any pilot group should be comprised only of pilots who are safety conscious, industrious, and cooperative. Clearly, this is not only an inaccurate inference, it is impossible. Pilots are drawn from the general population and exhibit all types of personality traits. Thus, it is important that good decision-making skills be taught to all pilots. Historically, the term pilot error has been used to describe an accident in which an action or decision made by the pilot was the cause or a contributing factor that led to the accident. This definition also includes the pilot's failure to make a correct decision or take proper action. From a broader perspective, the phrase human factors related more aptly describes these accidents. A single decision or event does not lead to an accident, but a series of events and the resultant decisions together form a chain of events leading to an outcome. In his article, Accident-Prone Pilots, Dr. Patrick R. Vayette uses the history of Captain Everyman to demonstrate how aircraft accidents are caused more by a chain of poor choices rather than one single poor choice. In the case of Captain Everyman, after a gear-up landing accident, he became involved in another accident while taxiing a Beech 58P Baron out of the ramp. Interrupted by a radio call from the dispatcher, Everyman neglected to complete the fuel crossfeed check before taking off. Everyman, who was flying solo, left the right fuel selector in the crossfeed position. Once aloft and cruising, he noticed a right roll tendency and corrected with aileron trim. He did not realize that both engines were feeding off the left wing's tank, making the wing lighter. After 2 hours of flight, the right engine quit when Everyman was flying along a deep canyon gorge. While he was trying to troubleshoot the cause of the right engine's failure, the left engine quit. Everyman landed the aircraft on a river sandbar, but it sank into 10 feet of water. Several years later, Everyman flew a de Havilland Twin Otter to deliver supplies to a remote location. When he returned to home base and landed, the aircraft veered sharply to the left, departed the runway, and ran into a marsh 375 feet from the runway. The airframe and engines sustained considerable damage. Upon inspecting the wreck, accident investigators found the nose wheel steering tiller in the fully deflected position. Both the after takeoff and before landing checklists required the tiller to be placed in the neutral position. Everyman had overlooked this item. Now, is Everyman accident prone or just unlucky? Skipping details on a checklist appears to be a common theme in the preceding accidents. While most pilots have made similar mistakes, these errors were probably caught prior to a mishap due to extra margin, good warning systems, a sharp co-pilot, or just good luck. What makes a pilot less prone to accidents? The successful pilot possesses the ability to concentrate, manage workloads, and monitor and perform several simultaneous tasks. Some of the latest psychological screenings used in aviation test applicants for their ability to multitask, measuring both accuracy as well as the individual's ability to focus attention on several subjects simultaneously. The FAA oversaw an extensive research study on the similarities and dissimilarities of accident-free pilots and those who were not. The project surveyed over 4,000 pilots, half of whom had clean records, while the other half had been involved in an accident. Five traits were discovered in pilots prone to having accidents. These pilots, have disdain toward rules, have very high correlation between accidents on their flying records and safety violations on their driving records, frequently fall into the thrill and adventure-seeking personality category, are impulsive rather than methodical and disciplined, both in their information gathering and in the speed and selection of actions to be taken, and have a disregard for or tend to underutilize outside sources of information, including co-pilots, flight attendants, flight service personnel, flight instructors, and ATC. The decision-making process. An understanding of the decision-making process provides the pilot with a foundation for developing ADM and SRM skills. While some situations, such as engine failure, require an immediate pilot response using established procedures, there is usually time during a flight to analyze any changes that occur, gather information, and assess risks before reaching a decision. Risk management and risk intervention is much more than the simple definitions of the terms might suggest. Risk management and risk intervention are decision-making processes designed to systematically identify hazards, assess the degree of risk, and determine the best course of action. These processes involve the identification of hazards, followed by assessments of the risks, analysis of the controls, making controlled decisions, using the controls, and monitoring the results. The steps leading to this decision constitute a decision-making process. Three models of a structured framework for problem-solving and decision-making are the 5P, the 3P, using PAVE, CARE, and TEAM, and the DECIDE models. They provide assistance in organizing the decision process. All these models have been identified as helpful to the single pilot in organizing critical decisions. Single Pilot Resource Management, SRM. Single Pilot Resource Management, SRM, is about how to gather information, analyze it, and make decisions. Learning how to identify problems, analyze the information, and make informed and timely decisions is not as straightforward as the training involved in learning specific maneuvers. Learning how to judge a situation and how to think in the endless variety of situations encountered while flying out in the real world is more difficult. There is no one right answer in ADM. Rather, each pilot is expected to analyze each situation in light of experience level, personal minimums, and current physical and mental readiness level, and make his or her own decision. The 5Ps check. SRM sounds good on paper, but it requires a way for pilots to understand and use it in their daily flights. One practical application is called the 5Ps. The 5Ps consist of the plan, the plane, the pilot, the passengers, and the programming. Each of these areas consists of a set of challenges and opportunities that every pilot encounters. Each challenge and opportunity can substantially increase or decrease the risk of successfully completing the flight based on the pilot's ability to make informed and timely decisions. The 5Ps are used to evaluate the pilot's current situation at key decision points during the flight or when an emergency arises. These decision points include pre-flight, pre-takeoff, hourly, or the midpoint of the flight, pre-descent, and just prior to the final approach fix, or for VFR operations, just prior to entering the traffic pattern. The 5Ps are based on the idea that pilots have essentially five variables that impact his or her environment, and forcing him or her to make a single critical decision, or several less critical decisions, that when added together can create a critical outcome. These variables are, once again, the plan, the plane, the pilot, the passengers, and the programming. This concept stems from the belief that current decision-making models tended to be reactionary in nature. A change has to occur and be detected to drive a risk management decision by the pilot. For instance, many pilots complete risk management sheets prior to takeoff. These form a catalog of risks that may be encountered that day. Each of these risks is assigned a numerical value. If the total of these numerical values exceeds a predetermined level, the flight is altered or canceled. Informal research shows that while these are useful documents for teaching risk factors, they are almost never used outside of formal training programs. The 5P concept is an attempt to take the information contained in those sheets and in the other available models and use it. The 5P concept relies on the pilot to adopt a scheduled review of the critical variables at points in the flight where decisions are most likely to be effective. For instance, the easiest point to cancel a flight due to bad weather is before the pilot and passengers walk out the door and load the aircraft. So the first decision point is pre-flight in the flight planning room, where all the information is readily available to make a sound decision, and where communication and fixed base operator, FBO, services are readily available to make alternate travel plans. The second easiest point in the flight to make a critical safety decision is just prior to takeoff. Few pilots have ever had to make an emergency takeoff. While the point of the 5P check is to help the pilot fly, the correct application of the 5P before takeoff is to assist in making a reasoned go or no-go decision based on all the information available. That decision will usually be to go, with certain restrictions and changes, but may also be a no-go. The key idea is that these two points in the process of flying are critical go or no-go points on each and every flight. The third place to review the 5Ps is at the midpoint of the flight. Often, pilots may wait until the Automated Terminal Information Service, ATIS, is in range to check weather. Yet, at this point in the flight, many good options have already passed behind the aircraft and pilot. Additionally, fatigue and low-altitude hypoxia serve to rob the pilot of much of his or her energy by the end of a long and tiring flight day. This leads to a transition from a decision-making mode to an acceptance mode on the part of the pilot. If the flight is longer than 2 hours, the 5P check should be conducted hourly. The last two decision points are just prior to descent into the terminal area and just prior to the final approach fix, or if VFR, just prior to entering the traffic pattern as preparations for landing commence. Most pilots execute approaches with the expectation that they will land out of the approach every time. A healthier approach requires the pilot to assume that changing conditions, the 5Ps again, will cause the pilot to divert or execute the missed approach on every approach. This keeps the pilot alert to all manner of conditions that may increase risk and threaten the safe conduct of the flight. Diverting from cruise altitude saves fuel, allows unhurried use of the autopilot, and is less reactive in nature. Diverting from the final approach fix, while more difficult, still allows the pilot to plan and coordinate better, rather than executing a futile missed approach. Let's explore each of the 5Ps more thoroughly. The plan. The plan can also be called the mission or the task. It contains the basic elements of cross-country planning: weather, route, fuel, publications, currency, and so on. The plan should be reviewed and updated several times during the course of the flight. A delayed takeoff due to maintenance, fast-moving weather, and a short-notice TFR may all radically alter the plan. The plan is not only about the flight plan, but also all the events that surround the flight and allow the pilot to accomplish the mission. The plan is always being updated and modified and is especially responsive to changes in the other four remaining Ps. If for no other reason, the 5P check reminds the pilot that the day's flight plan is real life and subject to change at any time. Obviously, weather is a huge part of any plan. The addition of data link weather information gives the advanced avionics pilot a real advantage in inclement weather, but only if the pilot is trained to retrieve and evaluate the weather in real time without sacrificing situational awareness. And of course, weather information should drive a decision, even if that decision is to continue on the current plan. Pilots of aircraft without data link weather should get updated weather in flight through an FSS or flight watch. The plane. Both the plan and the plane are fairly familiar to most pilots. The plane consists of the usual array of mechanical and cosmetic issues that every aircraft pilot, owner, or operator can identify. With the advent of advanced avionics, the plane has expanded to include database currency, automation status, and emergency backup systems that were unknown a few years ago. Much has been written about single-pilot IFR flight, both with and without an autopilot. While this is a personal decision, it is just that, a decision. Low IFR in a non-autopilot-equipped aircraft may depend on several of the other Ps to be discussed. Pilot proficiency, currency, and fatigue are among them. The pilot. Flying, especially when business transportation is involved, can expose a pilot to risks such as high altitudes, long trips requiring significant endurance, and challenging weather. Advanced avionics, when installed, can expose a pilot to high stresses because of the inherent additional capabilities which are available. When dealing with pilot risk, it is always best to consult the I'm Safe checklist, covering illness, medication, stress, alcohol, fatigue, and emotion. The combination of late nights, pilot fatigue, and the effects of sustained flight above 5,000 feet may cause pilots to become less discerning, less critical of information, less decisive, and more compliant and accepting. Just as the most critical portion of the flight approaches, for instance, a night instrument approach, in the weather, after a 4-hour flight, the pilot's guard is down the most. The 5P process helps a pilot recognize the physiological challenges that they may face towards the end of the flight prior to takeoff, and allows them to update personal conditions as the flight progresses. Once risks are identified, the pilot is in a better place to make alternate plans that lessen the effect of these factors and provide a safer solution. The passengers. One of the key differences between CRM and SRM is the way passengers interact with the pilot. The pilot of a highly capable single-engine aircraft maintains a much more personal relationship with the passengers as he or she is positioned within arm's reach of them throughout the flight. The necessity of the passengers to make airline connections or important business meetings in a timely manner enters into this pilot's decision-making loop. Consider a flight to Dulles Airport, in which the passengers, both close friends and business partners, need to get to Washington, D.C. for an important meeting. The weather is VFR all the way to Southern Virginia, then turns to low IFR as the pilot approaches Dulles. A pilot employing the
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.